We're live. Yay. Good afternoon, Amber. How's it going?
Good. How are you?
Doing great. Excited to be here and talking about what we're talking about and, you know, upcoming schedules of classes, but I'm going to let you talk about that later because you're on.
Okay.
But I feel like there's always so much to talk about every week, and each week I think that we're not going to have that much to talk about, and then there's more to talk about. So I'll just dive right in. Thanks for being here with us and wanted to just talk about, well, you know, it's almost like a broken record, low inventory, high demand, but the inventory is actually just a little bit higher than it was, but demand keeps going up. September and October have never been months for increasing demand, like, you know, ever. So seeing the increasing demand keep happening, we know that that's gonna just keep doing. I had to bring my trusty sheet out again. Demand's going up, inventory's down, prices go up. So prices are going up as they have been. But what's so incredible to me to think about is that we've gone up almost 18% in Phoenix this year, but since June, it's been 12%. So we know that this crazy low inventory is really, really just tightening those things up, bringing appreciation higher. And so what we keep, you know, broken record us, we need more inventory. So if anybody's thinking about selling, this is a great time. You're going to get a lot of money for your house, even with an election in, you know, a week. Some other things that are going, and also, when we see prices going up, rental prices are going up. Single family rental prices have been increasing almost as quickly as purchase prices have been going up. Phoenix, every single month, Corelogic puts out information on what's been happening, and Phoenix has been topping the chart for appreciation in the rental market. In August, prices went up 5.8% just for a single family rental. So it's really incredible to see how much that is happening, and it's really mirroring both sides. So again, if you're even waiting to get into a rental, don't wait. Some stuff that's happening that's kind of interesting on the resale, on the national level, on a resale front. So we always look at the numbers, okay, you hear the end of the year projections and things, or people are talking about 5.5 million transactions, pretty, like, that's a good year. That's a robust year. Sorry about my dog. In 2018, we had 5.5 million transactions. In 2019, there were 5.35 million transactions. These are good, healthy markets. What now, based on the September numbers of closings, what we're going to look at for 2020, 6.5 million transactions. It's mind-blowing to think that we're going to be a million ahead and our inventory is, you know, only like 40% lower than it was last year. So that just means, like, things, you know, I heard the joke, not joke, that houses are like toilet paper was in March, and it just, you can't keep them on the market. And, you know, we're really going to just keep watching as we see these transitions. And there's some kind of, as the movement is changing, and really depends on your market and where you are in the country. Phoenix, we've been pretty significant winners with a lot of people coming here. There's a lot of reasons why people keep coming here. But as we look at this, okay, I want to talk another second just on rental household growth before we dive too much into the other stuff. But rental household growth is actually outpacing purchase household growth. Owner-occupied houses, about two-thirds of the houses, about a third are rentals. But in some of the more expensive coastal markets, it's about 50% rental, 50% owned. So we're seeing more flexible movement internally where they don't have to sell anything. They're coming here. And I think that was pretty powerful. Another way to look at our tight inventory is if you think about the first 9 months of the year, in 2020, we had 400,000 fewer opportunities or fewer available listings on the market than we had in 2019. 400,000. It's crazy. Some of the things going to where people are moving: low tax states, better weather, you know, when you're less social unrest. So there's a lot of things that, again, why people are coming here. And there's been some kind of big winners and losers when it comes to movement. And I have it, I gotta look at my notes. So when you look at over the past 20 years, people's movement and how often people are moving has changed. We actually are having fewer people move today than we had 20 years ago. And then considering how much our market, we've got 200 people move into Phoenix a day, that's kind of significant when you think about it. That means a lot of these other markets, really, they're pretty stagnant. So you kind of look at where we are and the population kind of transformations. Population growth in Arizona, Utah, Idaho, Texas, and Nevada over the last 10 years has increased 20%. But population growth in Connecticut, Pennsylvania, New York, Illinois, and California was 3%. So we know that they're leaving those high tax places, going to low tax places, except for, you know, West Virginia actually had a negative increase or decrease. It's really interesting. I know I mentioned the movements and things like that of where people are moving. Some interesting, I just have to share because I think it's cool information that, you know, we're really seeing more movement and there's a lot of volatility in the stock market, and the stock market is getting even more intertwined with what's happening in real estate as more and more companies IPO or SPAC or however they want to go public. But this is interesting. On August 18th, the S&P 500 closed higher than it did the previous all-time high, which was February 19th, which essentially ended the shortest bear market in history. Thought that was kind of cool. Some cool things that are happening with Arizona. So Arizona, this is interesting. Arizona is the third lowest percentage of people that were born in the state. We are behind Nevada and Florida, and Louisiana is the most people that were born there and live there. Some cool stuff, and one of the reasons so many people keep coming to Arizona is the Greater Phoenix Economic Council, or GPEC, actually was just named the top economic council or top economic organization in the countries for cities with populations over 500,000, which is really cool. They put a lot of effort to diversifying our job market, and they've done a really good job, and I really think that's why we have the best, strongest job market in the country. Speaking of jobs, though, and we know that there's been some challenges over the last bunch of, you know, months with jobs. As we've talked about, delinquencies are still tracking loans that are in forbearance. They're just not negatively affected by their, you know, their credit's not negatively affected, but they are being tracked as delinquent. And so we've been really watching where we stand with 30-day, 60, 90-day delinquencies. And for the first time in the last 7 months, our 90-day delinquencies actually dropped. This is a very good sign for us that people are getting caught up, getting back into their payments, or they're selling the properties, whatever they are, they're not in that delinquency position anymore. And our 30-day delinquencies has actually gone back to pre-COVID numbers. So yes, we do have a lot of loans that are in delinquency, but it's not the end of the world, and things are starting to already improve, which is fantastic. Then there's, you know, then when we look at forbearance, there has been an improvement in forbearance as well. 200,000 loans came off of forbearance just, you know, this past week as the week before. Now, some of the things though that keep in mind when it comes to forbearance is that if borrowers, particularly with FHA, VA loans, if they are in forbearance, they are a 6-month period, and you can get it extended, but in order to get it extended, you have to call and talk to your servicer. Call and talk to the servicer. Please tell everybody you know that they need to call and talk to their servicer about getting extended, because otherwise they're automatically removed from the program, which is why they think that so many people are coming off of forbearance right now, because we're down to about 3 million loans in forbearance, is because they're not making that follow-up call to say, hey, I want to stay for another 6 months. Now, that's one of the things that just keep having these conversations, because we want to let as many people know what's going on with forbearance, and that they, and that basically borrowers have choices. They have options, and they need to know that they have options. And one of the things too, FHA and FHFA just extended the forbearance application timeline. So you no longer have just only 4 days. You have till the end of this year to get into a forbearance program, and they can last as long as 12 months. So we are looking at, we'll have forbearance options through the end of next year, which really does offer a lot of protection to a lot of borrowers to help them keep them in their houses. Last thing, sorry, I've been talking a long time. Amber, we were just talking about this in regards to lending. The Mortgage Bankers Association put out a statement that they believe that purchase applications or purchase mortgage originations in 2021 will outpace 2020 by 8.5%. They're expecting to hit an all-time high of $1.54 trillion. There's some purchase application money. So yeah, that's a lot. Amber, tell us what you think about that. Tell us all the other stuff that we talked about and what's going on in lending world.
Yeah, well, we love the purchase business. So I was really excited to see that. The refinances are amazing, but we want to make sure that we're proactively talking to our clients. The Mortgage Bankers Association also came out saying that they expect interest rates to rise through 2021 and maybe hit up to about 3.5%, which is still historically extremely low, but at that rate would almost eliminate refinances. So I just think making those calls to your clients to make sure that they've either refinanced their mortgage or they've analyzed if this is still the right home for them, and if not, had discussions with you about the timing of getting that house on the market and buying their new property while interest rates are at these insanely low interest rates. Such a beneficial call for you to make, and everyone's looking for ways to add value to their clients. They were estimating that we'll hit about $1.8 trillion in refinanced mortgages this year. And they're expecting that to drop to about $950 billion next year, and then in half again to about $5 billion in 2022. So refinances will taper off. And really the rise in interest rates is predicted because of unemployment. You know, we hit, you know, almost 15% in April. Last month we dropped down to about 8%. And it was always said that once we get close to that 5% mark, that the Fed will likely start backing off of the mortgage-backed security purchases, which is why interest rates are as low as they are. So you don't want any of your clients to say, I should have done something. And we know there's going to be people out there that do that, but be the voice for them, you know, be a sounding board, be their advisor, and talk to them about what their options look like right now. Because if they have any sort of agenda or plans to sell in the next 2 to 3 years, it really might make sense to talk to them about expediting those plans to sell in this incredibly great seller's market and buy with these insanely low interest rates. We're still seeing a lot of refinances. I mean, a lot of them. And we are taking about 60 days to close on a refinance right now because we're prioritizing the purchases and we want to make sure we're closing our purchases in 30 days because buyers need to be able to do that to be competitive. You know, they need every competitive edge they can possibly get. So just know that's out there, but there's a lot of opportunity that exists. And we're in the time of year right now where we need to start looking at 2021. A lot of people are really excited to put 2020 behind them and start afresh. And one of Sarah and I's favorite events we do every year is our accelerated business planning. We host a really cool class. We're going to do it over Zoom on November 4th. So watch for an invite next Monday. Maybe we'll put the link in the invite or post it maybe on Facebook or whatever. So you can go ahead and get RSVP'd for that. But we're going to talk about identifying 2 goals in 7 areas of your life to make sure that you go through 2021 more balanced than you did this year. We're going to talk about how to make 2021 your best year yet and really identify what business practices were you doing pre-COVID that have fallen off that you need to, you know, re-implement into your business. So we really, really hope that you join us there. That's all I had.
Awesome. I think that's great. And yes, business planning is very important. And I love what you said is what are the things that we stopped doing that we used to do that we should keep doing? We know that we should. And I really love that that we need to talk about that because I know that all of us have let some things go that are really valuable to our businesses.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Yep.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, as always, Amber, we so appreciate you, your awesome information and great suggestions. And you know what? I gotta say what you've been saying. I'm totally stealing your thunder and your line of basically if your buyers or your clients are not in their dream home right now, this is the time to do it. They need to really identify and look at where they are, what they want to be, where they want to be, and take advantage of these just kind of once in a lifetime opportunities with these rates.
Yep. Exactly.
Awesome.
Thank you. Thank you, Amber. All right. Have a good day.
Later.
All right. Bye.